This is one of the inaugural talks for Live Well Bethel Park. It's a new program. It's actually a partnership with Live Well Allegheny, which is a program of the Department of Health for the county. And we thought, why don't we go ahead and do a translation of this and to put it into action into Bethel Park. What can we do to really kind of improve the physical, improve the mental well-being, the general health of Bethel Parkers in the first place? So it's been one of my projects. My background is I'm an internal medicine doctor. I worked down at Mercy Hospital for about a little more than 30 years, all told. I retired out of my practice just so I could do a little bit of humanitarian work, and I've been doing medical missions for the last 3-4 years. But I also do, I double boarded in hospice and palliative care, and I do a lot of palliative care and hospice work now, too. But we've had a lot of projects in Bethel Park that dovetail in nicely with the blueprint of Bethel Park, our plans for developing the park structure, developing walking trails, our sidewalk trails, having Bethel Park walkability. We've asked our citizens over the last year, what would you like to see to improve? What can we improve to improve our community? And consistently we heard over and over, improve a lot of the infrastructures, the parks, improve the sidewalks, improve our roadways. People wanted like to have a downtown in Bethel Park. I don't know if that's going to be feasible, but we're looking at it, we're exploring it. But one of the things I'd like to do too is like continue to enhance as a physician. I see how important this is, especially with this talk that we're going to talk about today. So Sue, as our councilwoman for Allegheny County, I'd like to have you make a few comments about the program.
Sure. Hi everybody, I'm Sue Means, your Allegheny County councilperson. And so the county is partnering with the school district in Bethel Park and also the municipality for Live Well Allegheny. It's a big program altogether, so we're promoting exercise and eat right and preventative ways to be healthy and live longer. And if you're healthy, you're happier. Got a little tongue-tied there. But so we have some information on the back table about the Live Well Allegheny. But my background is in nursing, and I really strongly believe in preventative medicine, as does Dr. Campbell. And so exercise and eat right is the ticket to a long and healthy life. So thank you for letting me have a few minutes to speak.
You betcha. So I thank you. So I titled this program, look at the slide, Maintaining Health and Weight in a Biggie Size World. Who would have thought? Who would have thought? I'm going to start here. That's me. Check out the date on that. Where is it? 2013. That's a pretty hefty guy. Some of my friends here in the room actually I've worked with and have known me for quite some time, knew that I've struggled with weight my entire adult life, every single bit of my adult life. Every time my wife had a child, I gained weight. We had 6 kids, But you can see on that picture, I'm not really proud of it. I blanked out the important stuff like my date of birth, but just to give you an idea of what this is up close and personal to me, really up close and personal. So how did we get there? I was a good guy. I did the exercising I was supposed to do. I played by the rules. I was very, very physically active. Incredibly active. Did all my yard work. I exercised. I went to the gym. I ran. I was doing everything that I was told to do. I was told cut the fat in your diet. You have to cut the cholesterol way back. I was told eat a lot of healthy whole grains, tons of vegetables, tons of fruits. I was doing everything that I was supposed to be doing. And this is in the 80s into the 90s. And what happened? I got bigger. I'm not proud of that. You can't even barely fit my face in that little square, that's over there. And check out the date on that, 2017. That was a couple years ago. I was achy. I was stiff. I was short of breath just going up a flight of stairs, doing some of the yard work. I couldn't wrestle with the kids. I was snoring like mad. Drove my wife nuts. I was always tired, and I was always hungry. It was like I could never be satiated. My blood pressure was up, my cholesterol, my triglycerides went up, too, across the board. And every year, I'd resolve, New Year's Eve, oh man, I'm resolving, I'm going to lose weight. I'm going to cut the calories, I'm going to exercise more, and I'd have some success. I'd go up a couple pounds, and I'd lose 20, and then 30, and then I'd go ahead and gain it all back again. It was just the wild roller coaster that I was on over and over again. But each time, I'd pick up a little bit more. So New Year's Eve, probably about three years ago, I'm getting on the scale, and I thought, okay, I'm gonna go ahead and do it this year. We're gonna really make a big difference. So I get on the scale right before midnight, and I was 297 pounds. 297 pounds. I'm a physician, for goodness sake. I'm the doc. I'm the one telling patients, eat less, you know, exercise more. You know, what kind of example am I showing my patients across the board? Talk about being a hypocrite. That was me. Wholeheartedly me. 297. And you'd think that, oh, that's terrible, Tim, 297. You know what I thought? I thought, you know, if I gain 3 more pounds, I could start at an even 300. Who does that? Who thinks like that? You can tell how muttered my thinking was across the board. It's like, what? You know, what? What were you thinking? So how did we get here? I'd like to talk a little bit about historically what's been going on. In the 1930s, life insurance companies identified that if you were overweight, you had higher risks. Does anybody know what your life expectancy was in the age in 1900? About 40, 45. Through the Middle Ages, it was around 35. In Jamestown Colony, Jamestown Plantation, it was 26. In ancient Rome, it was 24. From 1900 to 1940, we increased our life expectancy almost 35, 40 years, right before we entered World War II. Why do you think that was? What made the difference? Pardon me? You know, after the Depression, well, that's true. That actually had some bearing on it. Sue? Bingo. Sanitation, because so many children died from young infectious diseases, it skewered our data tremendously. But in the 1930s, they said, you know, we see that if you have higher weight, you have a higher chance of dying. Therefore, we're going to change our premiums and give you a little bit of different rate for that. So they begin to factor that in when they were giving you in premiums for insurance. In the 1960s, there was clearly national surveys were done, and they started actually trending Americans' weight, really getting some good data. And they saw that clearly we're starting to get heavier across the board. And industrialization was thought to maybe facilitate our weight to gain, you know, push a button for your electric garage door opener, you know, electric or gas-powered lawnmowers, the remotes on your phone, on your televisions. And they thought all this probably has some impact. And they also noticed that we had a higher amount of fat and sugar content in our diet at that point. So Americans were living more sedentary lifestyles, and that was thought to have some big impact on the changes we see. So in the mid-1980s, 1985, NCP's National Cholesterol Education Program, USDA, United States Dairy Association, American Heart Association, American Diabetic Association, all of them got together. And they had some consensus guidelines. They said, okay, here's what we're going to do. This is the problem. We need to cut calories. We need to cut calories. Americans are eating too much. They said, Americans, we need to exercise more. That it's a mismatch. And this is what I was taught. I was going through med school in the 80s. And they said, Tim, you know, the reason people get obese is it's calorie mismatch versus expenditures. If you don't eat enough if you eat too many calories and you don't exercise enough, you're going to gain weight. And as a, you know, from the physics perspective, you know, matter can't be created or destroyed. Yeah, energy can't be created or destroyed. That kind of made sense. It made a balance equation. So they said, we need to exercise more. We need to eat less sugar, and we need to eat more heart-healthy whole grains. Heart-healthy whole grains. I heard that over and over again. High-fiber diets, whole wheat bread, oats. You know, the trouble is what we're eating. We need to eat better foods across the board. And then the biggest one was eat less fat. If you eat fat, eating fat makes you fat. I was told that over and over again by my nutrition classes, by the endocrinologists who taught me nutrition and taught me endocrinology. So the guidelines in the mid-1980s were pretty much, whoa, seizure, TIA, everybody take an aspirin. All right. So the guidelines are pretty much this. Do you remember the food pyramid? What's at the bottom of the food pyramid? Bread and grains, healthy whole grains, and then fruits and vegetables, and then sparingly, very sparingly, the oils, the fats in the diet, very sparingly the sugars. But we were told to emphasize that base. 6 to 11 servings of whole wheat grains a day. And then industry responded. We had low-fat everything, low-fat yogurt, low-fat dressings, low-fat, you name it, cookies. You can get that way as well. High fiber was being pushed into everything. Remember juicing came into favor real big. Let's get a lot more fruits and vegetables into us. Fruit roll-ups came, snack well cookies, the chips, rice cakes, oh, and every single flavor. Man, I had them stuffed in my car and under my seat in my glove compartment. I'm stuffing rice cakes. This is going to make me feel full. I'll drink water and just expand, and everybody will be happy. Then they came out with aspartame came out in the late 1980s. That's NutraSweet. And it was thought, this is going to make the difference. You know, we're going to be replacing the craving that we have for sweets with two amino acids that are joined together, and that'll take care of it. Tab, Fresca, Diet Coke, Crystal Light all came out. Gym memberships, they exploded all over the place. Running craze, that was huge, all the tennis shoes, dancercise, jazzercise, all the exercise programs, Weight Watchers, Jenny Craig, countless other iterations across the board. And then circuit trainers, you know, there's a zillion of them out there, different programs, but they came in vogue. And then industry also responded with like the liquid protein fast. Remember those? You just drink the five of these shakes a day and you're gonna lose weight, and that's all there is to it. Clinics just boomed like nobody's business. Then I don't know why they did this. They started giving people B12 shots and beta-HCG. Beta-HCG is your pregnancy hormone. Well, people get nauseous when they're morning sickness, so if we give them a shot of that stuff, they won't eat as much, right? Never really worked. It never worked. There was no even good data to show that worked. I love this. I had to get this. Look at the jogging suit with the little spandex. Don't you wish they had leg warmers, you know? But it affected our fashion as well, you know? The jogging suits came out, the designer tennis shoes, you know, the spandex yoga pants, leg warmers. This is great stuff. And then they started having, went a little later on into the 90s, we started getting the chat rooms, all the web groups that are associated, online counseling. Then they had countless apps that you can get on your phone really within the last 5 to 10 years. So yes, we can. You know, we're gonna do exactly what the experts are telling us to do, and America's gonna get fit. This is it. We're gonna cut the fat, we're gonna cut the sugar, we're gonna exercise more, and we're gonna reduce the amount of calories we're eating. And what happened? This is interesting. I'm going to see if I can get this to work. Now, I took these slides. These are actually from the CDC. Okay? This is the incidence of obesity. The light blue slides are less than 10%. There's no data on the white slides. The darker blue ones are incidence of obesity between 10 and 14% of the population in the respective states. Watch what happens over the next 15 years or 25 years. Bingo. So 85, 86, 87. Look at this. This is fascinating. Okay, all of a sudden, we get up around 89, and you know what? We better start adding some more colors because a lot of people there. So we're going to add another color, 15 to 19%, 892. This is the incidence of obesity in America per state by percentage. 95, 96. Look, we're getting more and more blue. Uh-oh, we have to add another color. We're going to add this one, 20 to 24%. Holy Toledo, that was pretty fast, wasn't it? Look at this, keep going, 2000. Uh-oh, we have to add another color, orange now in Alabama, 25 to 39%. Look at West Virginia, Indiana, Illinois, Michigan up here in this case, Texas. Oh, we have to add another color, greater than 30% in Alabama again, West Virginia. An absolute explosion of obesity in America from less than 10 to 15% to, as you can see here, by 2010, greater than 30%. What happened? What happened? We were doing what we were told. This is data right out of the CDC. And I just want to show you the slide today, what it looks like. That's today. Well, that's the most recent data. I think that's the 2018 data from the CDC. All right, the dark brown areas are greater than 35%. 25 to 30 years ago, the incidence of obesity was less than 10, 15% in most of these states. Yet within one generation, we see an explosion. Have you guys seen this data before? Has anybody ever presented this to you? This blew me out of the water when I read this. Absolutely blew me out of the water. So it's a nasty trend. 1990, no state had obesity rates greater than 15%. Greater than 15%. 2004, more than 30% of adults are obese. That's just what, 15, 14 years. Look what happened by 2017. More than 40% of adults are obese. That affects 93.3 million Americans. You know, and we don't even talk about these rates of extreme obesity. That's a BMI greater than 40. They've also increased tremendously. This is almost unheard of, extreme obesity 50 years ago. But now one out of 20 American adults are considered extremely obese, severely obese. So something's happened, right? You gotta admit. When did this happen? Of course, when I'm coming through med school, I'm having a young family, you know, and every time my wife gets pregnant, I eat the brownies, you know. It's affecting our children and our adolescents. Today, you could see that 18% of, or 13, almost 14 million children are affected with obesity. And you can look at the age range, 2 to 5 years old, almost 14%. 6 to 11 year olds, almost 18.4%. And look at that last one. 12 to 19 year olds, 1 out of 5 children are obese today. It affects some groups much more than others. Hispanics, 47% of adults are considered obese. Non-Hispanic blacks, 46%. Not so much with non-Hispanic whites, but we're still high again, almost 40%. That's still pretty significant. And non-Hispanic Asians, only 12.37%. So that speaks that there probably are some genetic differences with this as well, but it could be cultural as well. And again, as we get older, the incidence of obesity seems, currently the data seems to peak around middle-aged adults. And then after middle age, 16 older, and they tend to slightly, very, very slightly, you could see trivially decrease. So these are big, big stats. You know, I just want to do this to give you the scope of it. So how do we define obesity? Just by how, you know, looking at how a person looks at in Walmart, you know? No, we can't do it that way. Again, the insurance companies developed these actuarial tables in the 1930s and 40s to predict, you know, who we're going to insure, if it's going to be a higher risk or not. And again, too low of weight and you have an increased incidence of dying. Too high of weight and you have an increased incidence of dying. So it's about a bell-shaped curve. You want to do just what you can, just right. And if you think about insurance, the insurance companies are betting that you're going to live longer than you think you're going to. It's kind of an interesting way to look at it, but it's true. So they came up with the Metropolitan Life Tables. This is one of the first. Again, these date back to the 30s, 40s, and the 50s. You know, but for a particular height, depending what a small, medium, or large frame is, you should have a particular weight. Everybody has a large frame, or large frame. Everybody tells me they always have a large frame. I don't know what that means. Your bone structures are the same. What's a large frame? I could tell you as a doc, I never put much stock in that. So, again, we talked about the insurance companies knowing this, but they stratified even the degrees of obesity. If you're severely obese versus like a little bit obese, you have more risk factors across the board. Flip side of the coin, if you're underweight, you have a higher chance of dying. In fact, one of the other hats I wear, I'm also hospice and palliative care medicine. If a person has a non-volitional weight loss, if they're not trying to lose weight, and they drop about 10% of their weight in 6 months, their chance of dying or having a bad outcome in the next 6 months is about 50-50. That's scary. So I look for that very carefully in my patients. If they're not trying to lose weight, and they lose weight, something's up. So there's risk on both ends of the spectrum. That's the formula. We're not going to go into too much, but it's basically your height in pounds divided by your height in your weight in pounds divided by your height in inches times 703. Or if you want to go metric, you can go do it that way as well. But they've come up with a lot of nice tables by looking at the BMI. And again, healthy weights tend to be generally between 18.5 and up to about 25. Overweight is generally defined as 25 to 30. If you're obese, it's 30 or more. I like the colors, you know. Okay, yellow means caution, right? You know, orange means very caution, red means stop. All right, well, we can even break that down even further. And they've even gone to breaking down obesity into even different spectrums across the board. So all you do is you just take your weight and height, and you run it by your weight versus your height, then you come up with a particular BMI. So let's just say Tim Campbell was, 5'8", and he weighed 295 pounds, 7 pounds. I was here. That's not very nice as a doc. That's not very good as a doc at all. But basically, this is a good idea of visualization, because central obesity kind of correlates kind of closely a little bit with the BMI. A BMI of normal for a 130-pound woman, for I think it's 5'4", is 22. If you, that's considered normal weight. Overweight is a 25 to 30. That's about 152 pounds, for a 5'4" woman. Obese, class 1. Now look, we're breaking it down into different classes. Class 1, 30 to 35. That's about 175 pounds. 205, class 2 obesity. That's a BMI 35 to 40. And then severely obese is 40 or more. I was well above 40. 234 pounds for a woman who's 5'4". So there's limitations to the BMI. It's only so good. And I'll show you why. This guy, all right, does he look fat? But his weight versus his height puts him in an obese range. Why is that? Why do you think? Muscle mass. Muscle weighs much, much more than fat. That's why you throw butter in a tub of water, what happens? It floats. You throw a steak in there, what happens? It's heavier. It sinks. You know, so this guy would be considered obese by BMI. There's a whole other lecture I can give you on another thing called bone body density index, but it basically takes into account waist circumference. That's huge. That's really big. All right. So here, these are two guys. They're both 6'3". They both weigh 220 pounds. They both have the same BMI. But you could see there's considerable differences. And that's this body density index, which takes into account waist circumference. So waist circumference is big. And the best way to do it, you put your measure among the narrowest part, ideally, of your waist, measured against your hips. And those ratios give us some predictors. For a male or for a female, you have a low risk of, from the World Health Organization, you have a lower risk of cardiovascular disease if that ratio, if you're a female, 0.8 or lower. If you're a male, 0.95 or lower. The easiest way to test this that I do, if I know I'm doing all right, if I could put my pants on and my belt and I could slide my pants down, that's bad, because that means my waist is bigger than my hips. All right, just a rough little thing that I've learned over the years. So again, waist to hip ratio, and it's associated also very closely with the BMI. We get an idea how that correlates and actually is a better representative. But gee, Tim, you know, why are you telling all this? Okay, yeah, we get it. You know, nobody wants to be obese. I certainly didn't like to be there. I love that scale. Look what it's saying. Help. You know, there are risks. There are clearly risks associated with obesity. Generally, the more you weigh, the higher your cardiovascular risks are, the more you're likely to have weight-related illnesses. Obesity is the leading cause of preventable and premature death in the United States. The annual cost, to look at this, medical costs just related to obesity alone, if you factor out all the other costs, $147 billion, that's with a B, billion dollars a year. And for the annual medical cost of a person who's overweight or obese versus a person who is normal weight, look at that, $1,429 difference per year in their medical costs. A lot of things here. This slide's too small for you to read from back there. I'm going to review it. We know that obesity is associated with cancers. Women with breast cancer, colon cancer, esophageal cancers, and laryngeal cancers with men as well. Gallbladder disease. You ever heard of female fat and 40? That's it. There's a higher incidence of lithogenicity, making stones in your gallbladder if that's the case. Fatty liver disease. We're seeing more and more of this like mad. Because as weight increases, you get more fat deposition in the liver. It causes cirrhosis or a scarring in the liver. Hardly any of the scarring in the United States is due to hepatitis. It's usually alcohol, and it's usually fatty liver disease with a liver failure. Stroke, heart disease, breathing problems. We never saw sleep apnea commercials on television before, but now I know I can get mine cleaned if I buy a particular one. You know, there's advertisements all the time on it. We've never even saw that 10, 12 years ago. Kidney issues. You can have increased incidence of kidney failure. Look at this, diabetes, we know that. Deep vein thrombosis, blood clots in your legs, breaking loose, going up into your lungs, causing pulmonary emboli. For mothers, it's really risky, because there's a high chance of the baby being macrosomia. The baby's bigger, it's harder to deliver. The baby has more chance of complications as well. And if you take everything else out, factor blood pressure, family history, there's a higher incidence of premature death, just with being obese. Chronic venous insufficiency, the purplish changes that people see in their legs, swelling of the feet and the legs, the veins get destroyed when we get a little bit overweight as well. So all-cause mortality. You have a higher chance of dying if you're obese. High increased risk of hypertension. High LDL, that's the bad cholesterol. That's the one that clogs up your arteries. The HDL is the bulldozer. That's the one that clears out your arteries. And that's low. And then the triglycerides tend to be very, very high. That's the other fat in the blood. And we know that, how do you put a price tag on this? The quality of life scores suffer on people. People suffer with this illness. And it is an illness. It is an illness. It impairs your sex. It impairs your sleeping. It increases the incidence of depression and anxiety are associated with it. People have lower self-esteem and confidence. Again, how do I quantitate that? You know, this is huge, and now we're talking 40% of the population. 40% of the adults, as I showed you on the data before. Okay, Tim, I get it. You know, so great, you're telling me all this terrible stuff, but what are we gonna do about it? It's nasty, it's bad for us. We don't wanna be overweight or obese, you know, what are we gonna do? We're listening to the experts. We're doing everything they're telling us to do. We're exercising more, we're cutting the sugar, we're cutting the fat. You know, we're doing the things we should be doing. What else? I was caught in this roller coaster. Over and over and over again. So I'll give you a little history lesson. We weren't always this way. As I showed you, if you go just back to 1985, there was no state that had more than 15% of obesity in America. No state, but now we're over 40% for most of the states. What happened? So let's study the past a little bit and find out what's going on. Take a look at this woman. Where do you think she's from? Just give me a rough idea. She's Caucasian? What would you say? She could be from Greece. I could see some features like that too. You know, we can make some generalizations as far. I mean, that's what happens with the forensics folks, what they did. So she come from southern France. All right? She also lived 30,000 years ago. What they did is they found the skull, they took it to some forensic scientists and said, hey, we found this skull, can you tell us a little bit about this? So, have you ever watched CSI on television? I've never watched any of them, but they do all this wonderful, fantastic thing, like they'll take a pinky bone and make a whole person out of it, you know? I don't know how they do that. But they did this from the skull, they reconstructed the facial features of this woman that they had found 30,000 years ago. She was Neanderthal. She wasn't even Homo sapiens. She's hominid. You know, on our distant ancestors, but she was not, she was a Neanderthal. She's not Homo sapiens, as I said. But we still share our DNA, 99.7%. So there's an interesting fella. Again, I told you how they rebuilt her face. Physiologically, this is another reconstruction. This is a Homo sapien from, I think it was 20,000 years ago in mid-Europe. Our DNA has changed very, very little. Our genetics have changed very, very little over the last 30 to 50,000 years. So this is really interesting to a particular fellow named Dr. Lauren Cordain. He's a nutritional anthropologist at Colorado State University. And he said, you know, what better way to study what our Paleolithic ancestors ate, Neanderthals or Homo sapien, by studying what they eat today? So he did a really interesting study. He knew from the fossil records, from the remains that we found on a lot of these folks, that these people anciently were much more muscular. They tended to be even a little taller than we were. They had much more robust, fabulous bone health and dental health across the board. And everybody thinks they lived short, brutish lives, walked on your knuckles. It wasn't the case. They were very active physically, you know, and the hunting and gathering existence that they had to live. So he studied the modern hunter-gatherers, and he took 229 different peoples across the world. Everything from the tropics, the Inuit up in Canada and in far north Canada, Amazonian rainforest, Papua New Guinea, American Plains Indians, and looked at what they ate. And you can see the thing is, he thought this doesn't make sense. They're not eating anything the same. You know, Papua New Guinea, they're eating small game fish, tubers, and vegetables. In the Amazonian rainforest, they might be eating insects, small game, and fruit. And Inuits, they're eating seals and whale meat. Actually, Plains Indians, before a lot of things changed, sometimes up to 97% of their diet was animal based. So we don't see anything in common here. And he was perplexed. Dr. Cordain just didn't understand what was going on here. Again, they ate very little in common, yet I mean, they were different environments, different locations. Then he realized, you know, these people, they had no diabetes. They had almost no hypertension. They had no hyperlipidemia from what they could tell. And the existing people who are living today, modern hunter-gatherers, almost no obesity. Almost no obesity at all, no cardiovascular disease. It's like, what? What? Then he made the stunning realization. They're hunter-gatherers. They have no domesticated grains. They have no domesticated grains. And when were grains domesticated? Probably about 10, 15,000 years ago, maybe earlier, 20,000 years ago in the Fertile Crescent in Mesopotamia. But it's interesting, if you track the spread of grains across Europe, it took almost 10,000 years to get into Ireland and to Scotland. So, it's interesting, if you think about grains, they occurred all at different times in throughout the world. In Mesoamerica, the Mayans, the Aztecs, the Incas, they cultivated maize, corn. And if you think about corn, what is it? It's a grain, isn't it? It's a grain, it's not a fruit, it's not a vegetable. Mesoamerica, rice and sorghum, or Southeast Asia rather, rice and sorghum. What are they? Oh wait, they're grains. And then how about in Mesopotamia, wheat? And wheat is what took off and spread across Europe, across the board. Wheat took, again, about 7,000 years to spread from Mesopotamia into Britain, into Ireland and Scandinavia. And they're a wonderful innovation. The grains were a wonderful innovation. They gave us a stable food source. Some people would say that if we didn't have grains, we wouldn't have society today, because that's what helped us to settle down. That's what we had to do considerable less time hunting and gathering, so as such, we could do more, have centralization of people, have people put together in villages and small towns. That was the evolution of cities. And, you know, if I'm able to go ahead and plant wheat and I'm really good at it, and Patty can make a pot, you know, well, you make the pot all the day, I'll do the grains, and then we can work together. So all of a sudden we're seeing specialization. It's kind of interesting with how this developed and different cultures evolved around it. But now, today, we consume wheat 100 times more than any other grain. 100 times more than any other grain. And it's cheap. Think about it. You could take a 10 cent amount of flour and sugar and oil, and you can make a loaf of bread. You could sell it for $4. Especially if it's sourdough with a nice little crust on it, you know. It's easy to grow. We have flexible growing seasons. We can grow grains anytime, you know, across. We can have hard red winter wheat. It's very versatile to use. You could do a zillion things with it, too, across the board. It now is estimated that grains compose 45%, particularly wheat, 45% of the calories in the American diet. 10,000 years ago, none. All right. Since 1985, when all the experts started telling, you need to have more healthy whole grains. We saw what happened with the map on the CDC. More healthy whole grains. Since the mid-1980s, we've seen an explosion. Is this a coincidence? I think not, and I'll show you why. First of all, there is no nutritive requirements for grains in the human diet. None. We do not live. We do not need them to live. We do not. You see Wonder Bread down here? What was interesting about Wonder Bread? Fortified with 12 zillion vitamins and minerals, right? Why do they have to fortify it? Because basically it's famine food. There's no nutrition in it. Grains have no nutrition. Think about this. A bird eats a berry. The berry goes through the GI tract. A rabbit or a deer eats a berry. It goes through the GI tract. It comes out the bottom side in this nice warm culture media, you know, fertilized. And it can grow like mad. The bird wins, it gets the nutrition from the berry, the blueberry or the raspberry, and the seed gets deposited a nice warm amount of fertilizer. You know, both of them have a better chance of success. It's a win-win. What happens with the grain? Okay, here's a little mouse chewing on a little grain of kernel. If an animal or an insect eats a cereal grain, the grain is completely digested. All right, the animal benefits by the nutrition it gets from that, the calories that it gets from the grain. What does the grain get? Nothing. It's a lose-lose. The grain gets nothing out of the end. It's a biological dead end, so it's not good for the grains. So the grains have developed protective antibodies, protective nutrients within themselves to protect the grain, to reduce the chance of them being predated by being eaten. The grains have developed antifungal medications, you know, that protect them from funguses and bacteria. They've developed other little defenses in order to protect themselves. We have problems with it as well. These are some of the anti-nutrients that are found in grains. Wheat germ agglutinin compromises the lining of your intestinal tract. Do you know that there's been an explosion of peanut allergies? You've never seen so many in your life, have you? All right. When a person eats peanuts, all right, peanut butter, you usually eat a peanut butter sandwich, all right, with the bread. In the bread, there's wheat germ agglutinin that compromises the mucosal lining of the GI tract, introduces the protein of the peanut underneath the intestinal lining, and then you incite an inflammatory response. This is thought to be the model for why we see an explosion of a lot of the food allergies that we do today. And we know this really happens. They've actually taken frozen samples of soldiers from World War II, and compared them to current day soldiers. And we see that there's a tremendous increase in these autoantibodies today versus previously. We also see that there's a tremendous amount of gluten. Gluten-related diseases, celiac disease, has exploded also. We know that because we see the antibodies now are much higher. I think I read the figure fourfold higher today than they were in 1945. It's curious. Lectins will do the same thing. They'll compromise the gut mucosa. Serine proteases interfere with our digestion. But again, for the grains, this is good. It protects the grains. But for us, it's not so good. Phthalates, they bind minerals, so we can't absorb them. And then the gluten, as I said, it triggers a lot of inflammatory responses. And I've got a whole lecture I can give on gluten. I'm not going to bore you with that. But here, fourfold increase in gluten-related diseases in the last 50 years. Obesity has also skyrocketed in the last 50 years. We consume more grains than we ever have. 45% of our diet are now cereal grains. All right, and kicker is too is the wheat that we eat that my grandma Lenio made is not the same wheat that we eat today. All right, when she made bread, it was a radically different substance than the bread I eat and buy today. All right, why? Bread's polyploid. A lot of the wheats are polyploid. They have multiple genes. We add in a lot of different things for resistance. There's higher amounts of protein in it. There's more of this amylopectin A, which is a carbohydrate that we could very simply break down and absorb very quickly. So the correlation, there's the obesity epidemic coincides exactly, perfectly, with what we were counseled by the experts in the mid-1980s, 1985. We need to increase the bread in our diet. We need to increase the whole grains. That it'll be so much better for us, it's not even funny. It directly parallels also the increase of our sugar and high fructose corn syrup as well. Here's an interesting thing, a little aside on fructose corn syrup. Your liver preferentially metabolizes fructose. When you have table sugar is a disaccharide. It's two different types of sugar together. One's glucose and one is fructose. They call it sucrose. Well, we break that down pretty effectively, but fructose, or fruit sugar as it's called, is preferentially metabolized by the liver. So the liver crowds out, those receptors are crowded out as they try to break down the fructose. And what happens to the glucose? It stays high in the blood sugar, in the blood. All right, that is thought to be one of the mechanisms for why we're seeing an increased incidence of obesity may be associated with fructose. So high corn, fructose corn syrup, up to 65% of it could be fructose. All right, this also coincides at the same time we were told cut the fat out of your diet. So again, the case against grains. You can see where I'm going with this, folks. And I'm very passionate about this because this goes against everything I was taught in medical school. We have no need for grains in our diet. There's no physiologic need for grains. Do we need fiber? Yeah. Can you get that better with fruit and vegetables? Absolutely. All right. In fact, if you're going to juice, throw away the juice and eat the pulp. That's better for you. All right. Grains have almost no nutrition. They have very limited nutrition across the board, except for the calories. Wheat is mostly amylopectin A, this one carbohydrate that we break down very effectively, and it just jacks our sugar up like mad. And the glycemic index for wheat is higher than sugar. If I gave you a slice of white bread, your sugar will go higher than if I gave you a tablespoon of sugar. Huh. Didn't think that blew my mind when I first exploring that. This glycemic index, let's talk about this. Not all carbohydrates are created equal. If I gave you an apple, 90 calories, All right, you're going to see a slow rise in your sugar and a slow fall in your sugar as you metabolize that, as you break it down. If I give you a slice of white bread, 90 calories, I'm going to see a quick spike in your sugar and a quick fall. All right, so we handle different materials, different foods differently across the board. The thing is when the sugar goes high, your body secretes more insulin because your body wants to bring that sugar down and shove that sugar into the cells so we could store it. So this is what we see. If we have high glycemic index foods like chicken, fish, turkey, proteins, vegetables, we see, lower ones, we see a slow rise in the sugar and a slow fall of the sugar. If we have bread, pasta, the things that I love, all right, French bread, sourdough, I digress. All right, you get a quick rise in the sugar and a quick fall. Now, you know, we all like that. Oh, I love my bread. You know, oh, I love my my pasta. You know, I love my grains, my cooked cereal. Why do we love them? They're hyperpalatable, exactly. They jack up the sugar. We like the way that feels. Or, you know, we're used to that. It drives, it's very satiating across the board. So, just say we take a lunch. Say I give you a lunch of, a candy bar, the Snickers for the Thungers, you know. We're going to have a Coke with it also. We're going to have a hamburger, and we're going to have some potato chips. With that meal, you'll get, at noon, you'll get a quick rise in the sugar, and then you'll get a quick fall in the sugar. So even like 12:30, an hour later, you're getting hypoglycemic. So what do we do then when sugars are getting low? I'm hungry. I want to eat again. Now, if you had a complex carbohydrate meal, all right, say you had chicken or turkey with some vegetables, a salad. Say you had a glass of milk with that and some fruit. You get a slow rise of the sugar and a slow fall of the sugar. It stays much more sustained. Are we going to see that hypoglycemia afterwards? No, we don't. The complex carbohydrates, the complex foods that give us a sustained sugar are so much more satiating across the board. So the typical American diet is in the red. Breakfast. We're going to have pancakes and, you know, orange juice. Quick rise and then a quick fall. Lunch, I'm getting really hungry. I'm going to have, some fries and whatever. A sandwich with all sorts of junk on it. For dinner, we do the same thing. I'm going to have pasta and French bread or Italian bread. Or that roller coaster, where if we could smooth it out and follow that low glycemic index, we don't get the radical changes as much. This is huge. Glycemic index wasn't even considered until probably 20 years ago. I never knew about this when I was in medical school. It wasn't even talked about. So I call it sugar addiction, because it's the sugar that really is how our body responds to it more than anything else. So let's look at the glycemic index of different foods. Protein, chicken, fish, turkey, does that have any carbohydrate in it? Well, dark meat has a little more, of turkey has a little more carbohydrate than white meat, but for the most part, the glycemic index is zero. They based this on a scale of 100. 100 is if I gave you 100 grams of glucose, injected it directly into your vein, what would your response be? So that would be a real quick jump in your sugar up to 100 and back, all right? Well, protein does not give you any stimulation at all for the for release of insulin. And we're gonna talk a lot about insulin. So chicken, fish, pork, turkey, eggs, you know, really no budget at all. How about fat, oils? We were told cut the fat, remember? 1980s, cut the fat in your diet. It does nothing for your sugar. It does not jack up your sugar. It does not jack up your insulin at all. And here's what's interesting. Of all the fats that are out there, in the Framingham Heart Study, a study that's been going on in Framingham up in New England, they've been looking at this population, this city, this little town really, for 75, almost 80 years now. No correlation between saturated fat and coronary artery disease and stroke. None. None has ever been identified. You know, and you've heard of the French paradox. You know, the French eat all this fatty food. Yeah, they can remain thin. You know, and they have lower incidence of heart attack and smoke, heart attacks and stroke, unless they all smoke, which a lot of them do. But I've noticed when I've been there. Again, oils do not jack up your insulin. Do not jack up your sugar. How about vegetables? Now we're starting to see a little bit of budge. Think of 50 as the cutoff. 50 and higher is a high glycemic index. 50 or less is a low glycemic index. You could put in a moderate range in there for the most part. But look at this, bell peppers, broccoli, cauliflower, the cruciferous vegetables, onions. They only give you a little slight, they're made of carbohydrate, but they only give you a slight rise in the sugar and a slight fall in the sugar. You don't get these radical changes. Let's go on a little further. Nuts. one of my mainstays. I have this reckless abandon. I go through 2 ounces every day. And if Patty's not around, I'll have 4 to 6 ounces of it. But 15, cashews are a little higher, 25. But for the most part, nuts aren't giving you much more bump than the vegetables are. Legumes, beans, well, they're a little bit bump higher. 45, 35, 15, 40 for the different types of beans. Peanut butter, unsweetened, is 40. Well, Jif has quite a bit of sugar in it. So does Peter Pan. Just saying. Skippy. All right. Now look at the fruit. This is interesting. We're seeing a little bit higher, aren't we? This is look at the banana, the green banana. It's 35. But the ripe banana is 50. Why? It's sweeter, isn't it? As it ages, the carbohydrate breaks down. We could absorb it. It tastes more sweet to us across the board. Look at watermelon, 75. You know, but most of the other vegetable fruits, I kind of think are mostly in the 35 range. Apples, peaches, nectarines, they're pretty much around 35. Now, this is interesting. Let's look at the tubers, the vegetables, the fruits under the ground, so to speak. Carrots cooked are 40. It's not all that bad. Look at carrots raw. Why would a raw carrot be lower than a cooked carrot? The cooking breaks down the carbohydrates so we can absorb it more effectively. It'll jack our sugars up a little bit more. All right, baked potato, 95. Whoa, we're getting close to 100, right? 95 for a baked potato. Raw potato, 30. But who's gonna eat a raw potato? I'm Irish and I never did that. All right, dairy products. Now this is curious too. Check this out. Premium ice cream is 38. Cheap ice cream, you know, the ones in a little square that you can go ahead and buy, it's on sale. You can get actually 3 for $10, I happen to know. Look at that, it's 60. All right, why do you think the cheap ice cream would be more higher? More sugar, more additives, and there's more fat in the premium ice cream, isn't there? Spot on. All right, cheese is around 27, so they're not so bad. Milk's 43, that's not so bad either. Yogurt, unless you put a lot of sugar in it, they could be low. Greek yogurts are low, better, you know, across the board, less sweet. Now, let's look at some of the cereal grains. Hello, check out instant rice, 90. 90 for instant rice. Cornmeal, 68, couscous, millet, standard rice, regular rice, 70. You know, we're starting to see an elevation. Let's look at some more dairy products or more bread products. White bread, 75. I told you the table sugar is 65. This is based on 100 grams. All right. How about whole wheat bread? That's good for you, right? That's sexy. That's loaded in fiber. That's going to do us well. And it's darker brown. That means that's better for you. 65. Your sugar will go as high with a slice of wheat bread as it will with a tablespoon of sugar. 100 grams of sugar. Crackers, 80. Soda crackers. Man, I'd be slapping peanut butter on like mad when I was little. Waffle, 75. Now, spaghetti, look at the grains. They're not quite so high. They're in the 50s. They're in that gray zone across the board. Why? Because it's a different type of wheat. It's durum wheat. We metabolize it a little slower. Where the other wheat was loaded with amylopectin A, we could break it down very, very quickly. The durum wheats are a little slower for us to break down so that we don't get quite as much of a rise. Gnocchi, 70. All right, now look at the sugar. If I gave you pure glucose, it's 100. If I gave you table sugar, it's 65. Same as a slice of whole wheat bread. Honey, 62. Corn syrup, anywhere from 60 to 100. It could jack your sugars up. How about breakfast cereals? I had fun putting all those together. Look at most of those, 70s to 80s, up to 85. I'm gonna take a swig of water. Special K, I used to eat that like mad. I'm gonna lose weight, I'm gonna have Special K. Check out the glycemic index, 70. Of course, I'm putting a ton of sugar on it too. Graham crackers, soda crackers, shortbread, rice cakes. You heard me say that, 80. Now there's not a lot of calories in a rice cake, but it will jack up your sugar, more than sugar. Soft drinks, pretty much from 60 to 80. Gatorade, look at that. Everybody drinks Gatorade like it's going out of style. I'm just throwing more sugar down. Orange juice, tomato juice are much, much better across the board, not as high. Now look at this, a fruit roll-up. We dole this out to our kids like it's like nobody's business. Those little gummy bears, you know, and things like that. Your sugar goes higher with a gummy bear or a fruit roll-up. Fruit, it has the word fruit in it, right? That's good for you. No, it's not, because it's mashed, it's pulverized. So by the time we eat it, we absorb it. We hyper-absorb it. Microwave popcorn, 70. Chocolate bar, 70. Okay, I love that. That's a donut with an insulin needle in it. All right, let's talk about insulin. This is where we're starting to pull it all together. This is where, if you could walk away with one great point today, and these next couple slides are the ones I'd like to show you. I'm going to talk about high levels of insulin are not good for you. You know, we know that every time I put a patient on insulin, if they're diabetic, they will almost always start gaining weight immediately. Because what are they doing? Insulin takes the sugar from your bloodstream and shuttles it into the cell, and we store it as fat. That's what we do. That's how we protect it. So if you have high insulin levels for a long time, your body becomes resistant to it, becomes tolerant to it. So what happens, you have to secrete more insulin to get the same effect. You have to give more insulin shots to get the same effect. So most of the pills we give are basically, they do what they can to jack up your insulin secretion or give you insulin. You know, that's how they work. But insulin itself has some bad things that it does for us. It's great because it lowers the sugar. It's great because it puts us and stores fat in the cells where it should be, or the sugar in the cells where it should be. But it also causes a lot of inflammation. It causes inflammation to the endothelium, the lining of your blood vessels. And when that happens, it increases atherogenesis or atherosclerosis, the clogging of those arteries. Have you ever heard the term hemoglobin A1C? A lot of diabetics will get that checked periodically. An A1C is basically a glycated protein. If you have proteins in your body and high sugar levels, the sugar binds to those proteins. We can measure those sugars to find out how high the sugars have been over the last 3 months. A red blood cell will hang around your bloodstream for about 3 months, 90 days. So I could look back and see what the sugars have been doing. Patients come into my office, oh, Tim, sugars are great, 120. I get back the A1C, 14. No, I think you've been around 240 for your sugars averaging. You know, I can get an idea what's going on. But it doesn't just happen to your red blood cells. It happens to every single cell in your body, your joints, your cartilage, your muscles. And when you form these AGEs, advanced glycated products, we have no means in our body to get rid of them. They're there for keeps. They're there for keeps. So it's kind of like useless debris when the sugar binds to the protein. We can't get rid of them. They just deposit it. They call them AGEs, advanced glycated products, age, AGE, because they age you. They age the tissue. They make the tissue older. So more on high sugar. The sugar will raise your triglyceride levels. High sugar will raise triglycerides. Triglycerides are a fat in your bloodstream. Your cholesterol is also a fat in your bloodstream, but higher sugar levels will jack up your cholesterol levels. They will also raise your blood pressure. Again, I mentioned when a patient starts them on insulin, they tend to gain weight. As they gain weight, their insulin levels rise. So this is an interesting phenomenon. This is the slides I want you to really look at. When you have high sugar levels, for whatever reason, I don't care if you're drinking pop or if you're eating grains or you're eating a fruit roll-up, if you have high sugar levels, you're going to have higher insulin levels. The insulin level binds to an enzyme on your fat cell called LPL, lipoprotein lipase. The lipoprotein lipase says, oh, insulin levels are high. That means sugar levels are high. That means I should be storing fat. And guess what happened? We shuttle the sugar into our cells and stores them as fat. All right, so you can kind of think of the fat cell saying, oh, sugar levels are high, that means times are good, I should be storing fat. And that's what happens. This is the article that changed my mind. 2014, it took us years to get this study. This is out of one of my journals, Annals of Internal Medicine. And they took two different arms in this group. One group, they said, you know, we're gonna see if this low fat stuff or low carb diet really makes a difference. We're gonna take two groups of people. We're gonna give them the exact same amount of calories a day. We're gonna give them both 2,000 calories a day. We're gonna give them Fitbits. We're gonna have them do the exact same amount of exercise every day too. We're gonna find out exactly what they're doing, and then we're gonna do some other breathing studies and find out how much exercise they're doing. So they'll do the same amount of exercise, they'll have the same amount of calories. Now the things that I were taught when I was in medical school was, well, you know, calories in versus calories out. They're both eating 2,000 calories a day. They're both doing the same amount of exercise. They're both going to either gain weight, lose weight, or stay the same, the exact same. So no differences between males and females, no differences between other comorbidities. Let's see what happens. At 3 months continuing out to a year, one group lost twice as much weight as the other on the same amount of calories, on the same amount of exercise. One group lost twice as much as the other up to a year. And despite, you know, at 12 months at the study end, the same group continued to lose twice as much weight, have twice as much weight loss. And the winner, the low-carb group. Now, wait, Tim, what are you telling me about? In medical school, we all obey the laws of physics. You can't create energy or destroy energy. You know, how can this be? They're both eating 2,000 calories a day. They're both doing the exact same amount of exercise. One group should not lose more weight than another, let alone twice as much. The lower group, carb group, also had greater fat loss, not just muscle loss. When we lose weight, we tend to lose a little bit of muscle loss as well. But they lost greater fat amount. They had better HDLs. Remember that was the good cholesterol? They had lower LDLs. Remember that? That's the bad cholesterol. And they had better triglycerides. Their fats were lower by having a higher fat diet. Huh? The bottom line is, we obey the laws of biology and physics. We obey the laws of biology and physics. Again, this argues against everything I learned in medical school. These are what I was taught. We all obey the laws of physics. We all obey calories in versus calories out. But we also obey the laws of biology. And particularly, we obey the laws of endocrinology. Insulin is the bad actor here, folks. I'm not married to any particular diet or exercise program or anything like that. I just want to drive you home. Just a couple main points. Simple carbs raise the blood sugar. Blood sugars that are high blood glucoses, raise insulin levels. If you have higher insulin levels, it activates that enzyme on the fat cell, the LPL, lipoprotein lipase. If the LPL levels are elevated, then it says, oh, we better be depositing fat. We better be storing this energy. And that's what we do. Now, the antidote, if we do just the opposite, and this is what I did, the same things I put into my plan, my weight loss program, that is not marketed or it's not anything like that, you know. That's why I'm giving it to you. If you have lower sugar levels, you have lower insulin levels. If you have lower insulin levels, it activates two other enzymes inside your fat cells. One is called HSL, hormone-sensitive lipase. The other one is called adipocyte triglyceride lipase. Lipase means you break down fat. So both of those enzymes will break down fat. So if the insulin levels are low, your body's saying, oh, insulin levels are low out there. Sugar levels must be low. Therefore, I should be breaking down some of this fat and liberating it. And that's exactly what happened to these two groups of people, both having 2,000 calories a day, both doing the exact same amount of exercise. They were obeying the laws of physics, but now endocrinology is in play. They're obeying the law of endocrinology as well with that insulin. So here, the fat cell saying, hey, insulin levels are low. Times must be lean out there. I better start breaking down fat. I looked long and hard for that. You better enjoy that. Okay, so what are we supposed to eat? You know, you hear about all these different diets, the caveman diet, the paleo diet, the primal diet, the ancestral diet, South Beach diet. You know, I get whiplash from it. They started a number of years ago. Remember the My Plate? All right? All right, well here on my plate, look, grains went from here, 6 to 11 servings a day down to, okay, just gonna have a little bit more. Let's push the fruits and the vegetables. That was a step in the right direction. Let's throw in dairy, let's throw in protein. Chicken, fish, turkey, whatever protein you want. So my plate, I think, was a step in the right direction. But they made no mention on the My Plate about the simple sugars, or no mention of fats whatsoever. They make no mentions of the macronutrients or the quality of the food. So for instance, here's my color of my plate. I'm going to have a milkshake, preferably chocolate malt, with white rice. I'm going to combine that with a hot dog on a bun. I'm going to have sweet corn with it and a banana. Doesn't that meet the criteria? That's the way I ate. Quit laughing, Patty. Patty's my wife. she knows it's true. That's a D minus. The only thing that'll keep you alive for a little bit, but that's about the extent of it. That's a D minus. You got to remember, you know, remember like the Atkins diet? You know, people were losing weight on that. Now they're eating like red meat and Crisco and stuff like that, you know, but what kind of nutrition's in there? There's no good nutrition at all. So you got to remember the nutrition. This is not just a low fat or low carb eating. It's not what it's meant to be. So here's the Campbell modified plate. You'll notice it's a little bit different. When you go with low glycemic index fruits, have that about a third of, or a quarter of your table, of your plate across the board. Go ahead, do low glycemic vegetables. Fill up on them. They're wonderful. The more colorful, the better. They're loaded with fruits. They're loaded, I mean, vitamins and minerals across the board, particularly the cruciferous vegetables. Broccoli, cauliflower, huge, asparagus, wonderful, wonderful across the board. Yeah, you can have some dairy, have some milk. Doesn't have to be low fat, because we knew that from the Framingham Heart Study, there's no correlation between dietary fat or saturated fat and coronary artery disease. And then have some protein, preferably low protein, a lean protein. Some people say you don't even have to have lean protein, Tim. You know, you can have fat with it if you want. I figure I have enough fat stored up. I don't have to worry about that. So the four key takeaway parts: grains are not required for human nutrition. Low carb diets have great data for weight loss. And it doesn't matter which one you do. There's a zillion of them out there. But if I can make just one key point, if you do one thing, because 45% of our diets are now grains, minimize the grains in your diet. Get rid of them altogether? Heck no. Am I going to have a piece of birthday cake? Absolutely. You know, in my tradition, do we have pierogies at Christmas? Yeah. You know, I'm not going to deny myself that, but limit them across the board. Radically reduce the amount that you do in your diet. We should not demonize fat. Fat is not the bad actor here. And any diet can and will work. I have a son who's a vegan. He's been doing this as well. He just started, and he's had very good success losing weight. If you look at our dental structure, our anatomy, it supports an omnivorous diet. We're designed to eat just about anything. Just like Dr. Cordain saw from the Inuit Indians, Inuits up in Alaska and in Canada, down to the Amazonian rainforest. We eat nothing alike throughout the world traditionally. You know, we could survive. We're very effective and designed to go ahead and do that. Our dental structure, the way we masticate food, gastric biliary juices, how we can digest the different fats, salivary juices. I mean, when you take a bite of food, your digestion starts in the mouth. Not only when you're chewing the food, but the saliva actually has amylase, starts breaking down the carbohydrate. We're very, very well designed that. We're great at intestinal absorption. So proteins, go with lean proteins if at all possible. Commercially grain-raised animals, remember, they have a lot of, they're often fed corn-fed or grain-fed. They tend to be a little higher in the fats. But eggs white, you know, we can certainly do it with complementaries. And instead, I have a son that does this. He's a vegan. He does very well with it. But shoot, most folks, if they don't have kidney disease, 100 to 150 grams a day. Complex carbohydrates. That's beautiful looking, isn't it? We're attracted to that. That's something I would like to eat. All right, vegetables and fruits in all their resplendent glory. The more colorful, the better. But generally, the fresher they are, the better. They're better nutrition. Nuts in all their varieties, about 150 to 200 grams a day is what we're looking for. The fats, again, intellectually, this is the hardest for me to overcome because I've been told for generations, don't eat fat. You eat fat, Tim, you're going to get fat. Fats are satiating. They make you feel full. They will sustain you feeling a little bit full. There are also anti-inflammatory properties to it as well. Fish oil. I take fish oil caplets every day. There's great data in the orthopedic literature how much it reduces joint pain. You know, at 60, I need something along those lines to help reduce that inflammation swelling in the joints. And the nuts and seeds, they have a lot of fat in it, but they're good fats. They're anti-inflammatory fats. Now, dairy is interesting. Our ancestors didn't milk woolly mammoths. You know, they weren't up there. They didn't live very long if they tried that across the board. So dairy is not really necessary for adult nutrition. It's necessary for our children, but not for adults. We could live very well without it. But I look at this also from the data. As I showed you, cheeses, very low in glycemic index. Very low. So do I have some cheese every day? Yeah, I sure do. And they're also very high in calcium. They're very high in protein. They're very satisfying because of the fat in them. So the skinny, think outside the box. Shop the periphery. Do you ever notice this when you go to a supermarket? On the periphery of the store are the fruit, the vegetables, you know, the lean proteins, the dairy products. All the crap is in the middle. I don't know, every single grocery store I've gone to has the same like plan. Why? Because if you cut through the middle, oh look, there's some cookies, Oreos. I'll bring that with my milk, you know? But shop the periphery of the store. Consider having dinner for breakfast. This blows Patty's mind. I'll have a pork chop for breakfast if it was left over from dinner the night before. She says, I can't do that. I said, you don't have to. I need it. All right, so if you're gonna avoid foods with the simple carbs, you know, keep away from the sugars, the grains. Can you have them sparingly? Yeah, but do that sparingly. That should be the top of the pyramid. Cooked tubers like the potatoes. Again, sweet potatoes are lower than baked potatoes, but baked potatoes are pretty high. Probably, I try to keep away from them as much as I can. And avoid any beverages with simple sugars. You know, we talked about insulin being a bad actor. Do you know that if you even think about eating, your insulin levels go up? It's true. You even think about eating, you start to get a rise in your insulin levels. What does that suck? You know? All right, so the rise of the low-carb diets. And was this what you thought I was going to talk about today? No, it wasn't. So I took you on a different tack? Okay, good. Again, I'm not married to any diet at all. I truly am not. In fact, I call mine the Campbell Modified because I keep modifying it over and over again. But diets like the South Beach diet, Banting diet. Banting was actually the first doctor to develop this in the 1800s. Keto, you hear keto this and keto that all the time? Well, keto is actually a breakdown product of fat. So when you break down fat, you release ketone bodies in your urine. You could dip them and find them. So if you restrict your carbs enough, you will start getting ketosis. Ketosis is not acidosis. Acidosis is bad. Ketosis is not that bad. It's not that bad at all. Protein power, sugar busters diet, Atkins approved. That kind of evolved out of the old Atkins diet. Kim Kim, Sonoma diets. These are all basically the same principles. Every single one of these do the same thing. They lower the grains in the diet. They increase the fruits and the vegetables. They push the lean proteins. You know, that's pretty much what they do across the board. So here's what I think should be the new food pyramid. At the top, whole wheat and cereal. Just the polar opposite of what we were told in the 1980s. The pasta, yeah, you can have that occasionally. You can have your occasional donut on your birthday or a piece of birthday cake. Seeds and beans are also, when we cook them, they have a higher glycemic index. The dairy products, the nuts, the fruits, the lean meats, the eggs, the fish, the vegetables should be really the bottom of our diet. You know, they're loaded in fiber and loaded in minerals and lower carbs. This is what our hunter and gatherer ancestors ate. Exercise. Can you exercise yourself then? No. Because we are hardwired that if you increase your physical activity and there's no restraints on your calorie count, you increase your calorie intake. We have to monitor our diet. This is a combination of two. Exercise is important. Patty, where am I at 5 o'clock every morning? Most mornings, since we got back from Poland. No, last week and this week. I'm at the gym, and prior, you know, I work out. I'm on the elliptical for an hour every morning, you know, when I can, which is most every morning. As far as I do the light weights, also the exercise increases our bone density, our muscle mass across the board. But no data suggests that exercise alone will promote and sustain weight loss. You have to watch what you eat with it. Now, sleep, I love that picture. That could be my granddaughter. Sleep is so important. It's, I would say, mission important here. And we're lapping up. We only got a couple more slides. Average 6 to 8 hours. You know, for every decade we age, you require about a hour less sleep. I mean, 20 minutes less sleep for every decade you age. So compared to 30, 40 years ago, I probably require about an hour and 20 minutes less sleep. I can get by on 5 hours of sleep. I've got some of my patients who are over 100. They have 4 hours of sleep. They're fine. That's all they need. You know, 6 to 8 hours is ideal, but that's variable from person to person. But avoid nicotine, caffeine, and alcohol before you go to bed. They're stimulants. Make your room as dark as you possibly can. Get some white noise in the background, a little fan. If you have blackout blinds, use them. The darker the room, the better we sleep. We sleep better that way. Cool, dark, and with some white noise. And then play. Really, Tim, you're going to waste my time with a slide on play? It is. It's so important. It creates a sense of well-being. It's restorative. It nurtures and fosters. Look at that third one. Families and relationships. You know, that is so important because it's not just the biology. You know, we're social animals. We're wired that way. And we know that if you play, it improves your immunological health. NK cell activity stands for natural killer cell activity. Lowers your incidence of cancers. IgG, IgM levels are your antibodies. It improves your immune functioning across the board. Chemotaxis is your white cells are able to get into an area and attack them better when we play. They're much more effective. T and B cell activity, those are lymphocytes. Those are also important for our defenses. They're all enhanced across the board when we play. So last slide. Whew. You guys, nobody even, you know, had to pee or anything like that. I'm real impressed. You're incredibly unique. You know, we are by virtue of the fact that we're here today with our ancestors, we are the evolutionary successes. We are the ones that made it. The poor Neanderthal girl, she didn't. Homo Neanderthalus, the Denisovians, they didn't make it. Homo erectus didn't make it. Homo sapiens did. And a lot of that's because of this up here, our brain, you know, but also because we're incredibly adaptable. These suggestions, notice this, one size fits one. I'm not coming up here and say I'm selling a book or anything like that. I'm just giving you some general principles of why all these diets work, all these new plans. One size fits one. Eat and live the way you were designed to eat, which is just about everything, but keep away from the cereal grains, and that's it. Don't get sucked into the fad diets like I'll just have cabbage soup for every night, week for a month, or a hot dog or a grapefruit diet. You can't sustain that. That's crap nutrition anyway. You know, enjoy life to its fullest. Eat well, sleep, play, and relationship build. And I think that's about it. Was this radical change from your thinking? It was for me. You know, I've gotten bits and pieces of this, but I've never seen it put together in one place like this. You know, and that's why I wanted to share it with you, because I have been able to keep off. I mean, you can tell I'm not skinny by any stretch of the imagination. I'm in that borderline area between obese and overweight. I'm just there. I don't think I'll ever be normal weight. But I have had 22 cousins. All of them were over 250 pounds at one, you know. I've had, my mom and dad were heavy. My sister and my brother were very, very heavy across the board. I'm the skinny Campbell. It's hard to say, imagine that. You know, but biology has a lot to do with this, but environment has a lot to do with it as well. And I just wanted to share this with you because I think this is something that can work, and it's good. I think it's good data that I wanted to share with you. Any questions in particular? Sir? Yeah. Soy, again, it's a legume, isn't it? You know, soy milk.
Yeah.
All right. Low glycemic index. But for a lot, you know, if people can't tolerate, they're lactose intolerant. I say sure, go with almond milk or go with soy milk across the board. Soy. Have you ever heard of the phytoestrogens? Soy is a natural source of a phytoestrogen. So it can bump estrogen levels in some folks. That can be a little deleterious for developing, you know, adolescent males in particular. For women, history of breast cancer, it might conceivably be an issue as well, but there's not real good data on that, you know, so. But it's relatively low glycemic index. If we're looking at it from the perspective of weight loss, it's fine. You know, it doesn't jack up your sugar levels much. You wild thing. You party animal, you. Good. Other questions, please.
What do you recommend, a good website for glycemic index information?
You know, most of the data I got is actually from University of Sydney. They have, I think, the best collection of data specifically on glycemic index. There's also something called glycemic load. For instance, glycemic load is, all right, say we take something like apples, which are relatively low in glycemic index 35. But if I eat like 4 or 5 pounds of them, you know, that's a lot more carbohydrate. I didn't even address that. So it does matter not only the quality of food you eat, the lower glycemic index foods, but also involves the quantity of food that you eat as well. And there's a lot of great tools out there to suggest how many calories you should be eating a day, you know, depending on your sex, on your weight, and your physical activity, and your age. You know, there's a lot of apps for that can look at it. Please.
What's your opinion on water consumption? Designer water, regular water, flavored water?
Well, if you live in Flint, Michigan, you know, you have a little concerns with the lead. You know, thankfully in Bethel Park, we're in pretty good shape. What do I drink mostly? Tap water. I do. We had a filter on our our refrigerator. Patty uses it a lot more than I do. I think filtered water is probably better if you could do it. Do I have problems like with using like a lot of bottled plastic water? Typically, I don't drink much of this just because of the cost of it. You know, as far as electrolytes and how much to drink, electrolytes are important, but we get most of those from our nutrition. You really don't need to have it in your water, you know, for the most part. How much water should you drink? I was always told 8 glasses a day when I was growing up. There's no data from that. That came from the 1940s, that information. Nobody ever did a study to look at it. None. No data on 8 glasses a day. I haven't a clue. They just said 8 ounces a day. I haven't a stinking clue. I consider a glass a lot more than 8 ounces, you know. But the way I was taught from the endocrinologist who taught me, and this makes a lot of sense, drink till you're satiated. Drink till you're full. All right. It depends on your environment, too. For instance, I've done a lot of humanitarian work, medical missions. I've been in some environments where it's like 110 degrees consistently day after day and 100% humidity. And you sweat. You can't evaporate. It just rolls right off you. When I was on a Navy ship, on the Comfort, on three tours with them, I drank between 4 to 6 liters of fluid a day, water a day. Water, not salts. You know, we would have salt tablets available for us, but most of us would just, you know, just consume regular food with it. So water, drink till you're full, till your first thirst is slacked. Electrolytes, you really don't need to do that. As far as like, you know, ionized water and all this other crap that they added, there's no data on that. You know, Fiji water, well, yeah, go for it if you want to spend it, but I don't. I'm too cheap. Intermittent fasting. Okay, good. Very important. You notice I kept coming back to the point of insulin. All right. If you intermittently fast, what happens? What happens to your sugar levels? They drop. All right. There's some good data for intermittent fasting. And there's a lot of other little tricks that we could do to amplify that. The ketones that we get when we intermittently fast, the ketones when we break down fat, ketones, beta-hydroxybutyrate, goes up into the brain. It tells the brain, hey, they're fasting. You don't want to be too distracted with this. Acetoacetone is another one. And it tells our brain, okay, you're full. Don't eat as much. All right. So when we fast, when we intermittently fast, we make more ketones. It actually tells us you're not as hungry. It's a feedback loop into the brain. So it's pretty effective. There's some other great things that look like for intermittent fasting as well. We know that when the insulin levels are low, and they've done a lot of other animal models with this, it seems to be associated with longevity. Animals living longer. When they fast certain animals, animal systems, I think it was mice, they showed a profound increase in their life expectancy when they did intermittent fasting. There's actually a trial going on right now from, I think it's called the National Institute of Longevity, to look at human intermittent fasting to see if we can increase our life expectancy. On your DNA, you have genes, and then you have all this junk DNA on the outside. Probably 90% of our DNA is junk. It doesn't code anything. It doesn't make any protein. Every time a cell replicates and turns over, you cleave off a little bit of that junk DNA on the end. We call them telomeres, all right? And as you cleave off more and more, as the cells replicate over and over again, you get shorter and shorter cells, and then you get into the gene, and the gene dies. It has been estimated that if we treat all cancer, all coronary artery disease, all vascular disease, all diabetes, all hypertension, all hyperlipidemia, that we will probably live to about 120 years of age. If we cure everything, we could probably live about 120 years of age. And then we die. We wear out. And the reason we do is this apoptosis, which means programmed cell death. Our cells will die after so many replications because as they cleave off that junk DNA and out of the telomere and they get into the gene dies, and then the cell dies, the tissue dies. So a lot of things are being looked at now. What can we do to lengthen those telomeres? What can we do to expand them and make them a little bit longer? Intermittent fasting has been broached as one of the means that maybe that might be one of the mechanisms of action, that when you fast, your body goes into a conservation mode to preserve the telomeres so we don't reproduce ourselves as much. There's a lot of science being looked at also. Are there medicines? Are there things that we can do? Case in point, you remember Dolly the sheep when she was cloned a number of years ago? Dolly was cloned with her mom, I think, was 2 or 4 years old, which I understand is like midlife for a sheep. So when they cloned her, they took her DNA, put it into an egg, and implanted it. And then Dolly the sheep was born. She was born with two-year-old DNA or four-year-old DNA. I can't remember how old she was. So by the time she was middle-aged, she was already showing a lot of advanced arthritis in her joints because her DNA was already old. So that's going to be the next real great frontier. What can we do to expand telomeres? And could intermittent fasting do it? There's some good stuff for that. And I think a lot of that is insulin-driven. Great question. I'll answer more like those. Other questions, please?
Bigger as we get older, we're also in Alabama, Mississippi, and younger getting bigger real quick.
Throughout the country.
What is the trend going to be versus what we eat and the advertising coming out of the supermarket?
Yeah, you know. You know, you look on television, my granddaughter's over the house and she's looking, you know, those cookies look pretty good, you know. I mean, advertising, it's like crack, you know. We could really be led down a rabbit hole with like how much the psychological influences of a lot of the food, the commercials, food complex, you know, industrial complex and its impact on us. That's a hard question to say. Thank God I'm just an internal medicine doc and not a psychologist, you know. But I think it has big impact because I think we could be swayed. And a lot of the way these foods are designed, they're designed to be hyper palatable. The higher the fat content combined with sugar, we love that sensation. It tells our brain, this is great stuff, eat more of it. If our ancestors could find honey, it was a score of a day. You know, this is sweet stuff. But and why do we like that? Because we're wired to like that. If we could find it, it's great. We could use these resources and store them. The kicker is we're finding honey every day, three times a day, you know. So, yeah, I know I did a scoot around your question, but I probably did about best I think I can.
But it's difficult because you're in so I work at 60 Street, right? Mm-hmm. There is nothing in that cafeteria that I eat.
I know.
But everybody eats because it's the only game in town.
Yep.
And even if you go outside, there's like 300 fast food restaurants that sell the same stuff.
Right. And fast food, you know, it's designed to be hyper-palatable. I like that word, hyper-palatable, because we love to consume it. It makes us feel good. You know, raises your sugar levels. The fat's satisfying with it, especially that combination of fat and sugar. Oreo cookies. Cheesecake. Yeah, cheesecake. Oh, my word. Other questions? Ma'am. The Campbell modified, because I keep modifying it over and over again. Let's go. Oh, this one. Wait. No. I have two ones. Here's the this is what I think should be the contemporary food pyramid. Pardon me? I don't think so. Well, I'll tell you what. No, but, well, you know, to level with you, I'll level with you. When I was doing some of my mission trips, I'd be working with nutritionists. They hated me for what I was telling them. They thought I was absolutely crazy. There's no evidence behind that. I just showed you an hour and a half worth of evidence, you know? It's just overwhelming evidence for it. And the kicker is I look at myself, you know, Patty will tell you, I'm not a zealot with this. I mean, there's times I'm way off the wagon. I'm way off the reservation, you know? But the vast majority of the time, I'm sticking with this. And it works for me when I do. My snack of choice, nuts. Like I buy a packet at Target, they have exactly 1 ounce in a little while. Because if I have a can, I'm just eating handfuls of them, you know. But they have measured packets. Where are they at, Patty? Stuffed in the side of my doors, you know. Quest bars, have you ever seen those? That's it's whey protein. 20 grams of protein. The sugar sweetener is erythritol. You know, it's in sugar alcohol. You don't get the spike in the sugar like you do. That's my breakfast for most mornings if I don't have time to make some scrambled eggs or have a pork chop left over from the night before, you know? Please.
Do you have a favorite bakery?
I'm from any bakery, Patty said. I truly do. No, I was born and raised in Bethel Park. You know, Bethel Bakery made my wedding cake. I've got to say them, you know? All right, please.
We
well,
no,
that's fine. You know, again, these suggestions are really more for weight loss than really cholesterol reduction. We know that oats will reduce your cholesterol. We know that broccoli and cauliflower will reduce your cholesterol, you know. But nobody's gonna, yeah, not too many people are crazy about having broccoli for breakfast, but I do. I do. As of this morning, I'm still down. I had lost a total of 100 pounds. As of this morning, I'm still down 85 pounds. You know, still got a lot to go. But again, this is a life effort for me. You know, what kind of example was I making for my patients over the years? You know, what kind of example was I? Or my kids? And we wonder why we propagate this over and over again. Other questions? Ma'am? Not really. I mean, biologically, you're built with what you're built with, you know. I have no means of changing that. Having said that, there are a couple little things that a person can do with a, quote, low metabolism. We've done actually studies on these in the 90s, and like a low metabolizer. First of all, no, you have to listen harder. No, in the 1990s, they did a lot of study on calorimetry studies where they put people in these machines, these boxes, and they measure how much carbon dioxide they eat with different amounts of food. And surprisingly, our calorie count doesn't vary as much as you think. If you diet for a while and you're losing weight, your body becomes more effective, more efficient. You actually use your calories much more efficiently, and you burn less calories. It's a conservatory mechanism that our body puts in play. To maybe the degree of about 100 to 200 calories a day. That doesn't sound like a lot, but a candy bar is 200 calories a day. If you take 200 calories a day times 365 days a year, divided by 3,500 calories per pound, a candy bar, 200 calories, could be 20 pounds you can gain. One candy bar, you know? So as far as like changing your biology, well, they used to do that. Remember, I showed you the slides, they give shots of beta-HCG, make you think you're pregnant, or some people thought B12 shots would help. There's no data for any of that. That's it. They used to give thyroid medications and rev it up. All that did was give people AFib, you know? It didn't help you at all. It really doesn't. So the best thing you could do is the physical activity. That's how you can make up the difference. If you don't burn calories at a normal rate where most people, and there's a little variation from people to people, then how do you make up the difference? Physical activity. You know, try to step up the activity. Okay. Other questions?
What happens when you are doing, you're eating, you're adapting, or you're, you know, you're following a different plan, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you hit that plateau.
Mm-hmm. What I've done now in myself, I've hit the plateau more times than you could shake a stick at it. In fact, the term for this in the literature is called the whoosh. Have you ever heard that term? The whoosh. People will hit a plateau and they'll stay there for a long time, and usually you have to do some sort of change in your activity. I mean, some folks recommend, oh, increasing your calories because your body's getting more effective and efficient, you know. But generally I found that if you increase the physical activity, even like 100 or 200 calories more that you burn a day. For instance, 60 minutes of me on elliptical, I burn 700 calories a day with that. I do weightlifting for about a half hour, I burn another 300. That's 1,000 calories right there. A pound of fat is 3,500 calories. So every 3 days, I could lose a third of a pound just by my physical activity alone. So that makes a big deal. They call it the whoosh because, curiously, when people hit this plateau, a lot of that has to do with the fluid that we're holding on to and we're retaining. And then the whoosh is when, all of a sudden, boom, people drop 2-3 pounds all at once. An average woman will lose 3/4 to 1 pound per week if they calorie restrict and they do a lot of physical activity. That's average across the board. Men, 1.5 to 2 pounds per week, almost twice as much. But I figure, you know, that sounds like that's really unfair, but women live on average 8 years longer than men, so, you know, I think you guys get it in the end, you know. Patty says, yeah, but who wants to live 8 years longer if you're overweight, you know. Other questions? You guys have been awesome. I hope this is helpful. I really do. I hope you walk away with some different information than you had when you came in. More importantly, I hope you put some action into your lives, because I think there's good science behind this, and that's what I wanted to share with you tonight, just the good, solid science, and explain why all this plethora of diets that you see out there, you know, all of them, they basically work the exact same way. Oh, there's my Campbell modified plate, yeah. Okay, folks, thank you.